I've been preaching a series, as you can see on the overhead here, called Our Calling to Overcome, and it's out of the book of Judges where I've been preaching. The last two sermons I preached on, just to kind of help you see how this flows together, is basically on how to pass the test, because there are times we go through difficulties in lives, we face temptations, or we go through challenging circumstances, and we have to pass the test that we find ourselves in at that time. And then in my last message, I preached on our path to victory. And I ministered on that out of what the people of God were dealing with in the book of Judges, because we need to know how to be successful in fulfilling the will of God for our life. How many know that God has a path of victory for us? And you got to find that path, and you got to stay on the path. What happens when you deviate from the path? You fail. You mess up. You don't experience the victory like God has for us. And I believe God wants us to prosper. I believe He wants us to be blessed. How many are glad that God blesses His people? Amen. So thank God for that. So there is a path to victory. Well, this morning, I want to preach on the story of Gideon that's found and begins in Judges chapter 6. They actually cover several chapters. But this morning, I want to preach about something specific, and that is what God sees in us. What does God see in you? What does God see in us? God saw some things in Gideon and challenged him on that, called him to that. And I want to show some principles from the Word of God that speak to what God sees also inside of us, because I believe that we need to become the people that God wants us to be. And so I think that's significant. So let's start reading, and I want to begin reading with verse 1 and the first 10 verses. It says there, "The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, so the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel, because the Midianites, the children of Israel, made for themselves dens and caves and strongholds which are in the mountains. So it was whenever Israel had sown, Midianites would come up early. Also Amalekites and the people of the east would come up against them. And they would encamp against them and destroy the produce of the earth as far as Gaza, leaving no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep nor ox nor donkey. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, coming to the as numerous as locusts. Both they and their camels were without number, and they would enter to the land to destroy it. So Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord because of the Midianites, that the Lord sent a prophet to the children of Israel, who said to them, 'Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you out of the house of bondage, and I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians and out of the hand of those who oppressed you, and drove them out before you and gave you their land. Also I said to you, I am the Lord your God, and do not fear the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell, but you have not obeyed my voice.'" How many of you know that last phrase is why they were going through everything that had just been described? The tragedy, the heartache, the terrible distress that they found themselves in, at the mercy of anybody that wanted to invade them. And particularly the enemies kept coming in just as they would sow their fields and get ready to later reap a harvest so they could feed their families. And the enemy would come in deliberately to destroy the produce of the land, to steal their crops, to steal what livestock they had. It was a terrible plight. This went on for 7 long years till they finally cried out to God. And how many are glad that we can cry out to God and we can turn to the Lord? So this is basically the summary of what you see going on here. A man named Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, he once said this, and I have a PowerPoint of it. It says, "If you treat an individual as he is, he will stay as he is. But if you treat him as it were what he ought to be and could be, he will become what he ought to be and could be." Now that's a powerful statement, and there's a lot of truth packed inside of that, but I want to point out to you, this is a partial truth, and I'm going to show you from God's Word, because that is true. We do need to treat people like they can be, so that it will give them the hope to raise up and be better than they are, but that's not all fully true in that. There's more to that statement that I believe needs to be added to that. But it's overall a good principle to look at, because how do you know that we need to become better people? And especially as children of God, people of God, followers of Christ, we need to become more and more like Christ to become what God calls us. And I would add, what God sees in us. So let's look at what God sees in us from this story and learn some things that apply to our lives and encourage ourselves and one another in the Lord. But before we look at what God can do in us to bring us to a better level, the first thing you got to see is what happens in these verses that I just read to you, and that's this truth. God confronts the issues that hinder His will in our lives. And that's an important thing that you've got to start off with. You see, the reason it's important that I begin with this point is because there is a tendency within inside of the modern church and in our society today and within Christianity to avoid doing exactly this. Have you noticed that? There's a tendency today to avoid talking about sin, to avoid pointing out the negative or what's wrong. We only want to be positive. We only want to, we only want to just focus on the good and so forth. Well, let me tell you something. God doesn't always just focus on the positive, on the good. He does bring light to that because He wants us to come into that. But before God can bring you into the good, how many know He has to deal with the bad? It's called conviction. It's called calling people to repentance. And see, the church today, people want to skip that. They want to overlook that. Sometimes we have to have a reality check. Turn to your neighbor and say, a reality check. Reality check means you look at what is really going on, and you face it, you talk about it, you address it, and then you figure out what you need to do to overcome, to change. In my years as pastoring, I've been in several churches now, and there are good times, there are bad times, there are difficult times. You have all these, it's a cycle that you go through periodically. And so there have been times where we were struggling or having a difficulty, and as a pastor, I felt I needed to address it, and so I'd just call it what it is and have people start praying about it. And I had someone once that complained, said, "Pastor, you can't talk like that. You'll drive people away." I said, "Well, how can you not talk about it if you need to repent or you need to fix something?" How many know just ignoring the fact that you got a broken arm ain't going to get it healed? Or a worse disease, or something worse. If you got cancer, you can't just ignore that you got it. You got to address it. You got to either go get the doctors to treat it, or you need to have faith and pray and maybe do both. But you got to say, "God, I need healing." And how many know you got to call the elders of the church and be anointed over and prayed over, and God will heal the sick. But if you just ignore it, how many know that stuff's going to take you out? And so we have to address this. God can do anything good in and through us, but He won't do that until He deals with the sin that's in our lives and He fixes the spiritual, the emotional problems, and the character issues that people have. And so that's kind of why I start off with this point. God confronts the issues. He confronts the sin. He deals with those things that hinder His will from being done in our lives. A couple things out of this first part of Judges chapter 6 will help you see that. First of all, out of verses 8 and 9 is this simple truth. God reminds us first of what He's done for us. How many are glad God's done some awesome things in your life? And God reminds us of those things. So before He actually comes and slams them, convicts them, points out, "You didn't obey My voice, and basically this is why all this bad stuff has happened to you," God, I think, wanted to encourage them. How many are glad He's an encouraging God? So He reminds them of all that God had done for them. He spoke to them and said, "Hey," He sent them a prophet. We don't even know who the prophet was, but He sent a prophet to them, and He said, "Look, I delivered you out of the house of bondage. I brought you out of slavery in Egypt. I delivered you from all that. Not only that, I also delivered you from the hand of numerous enemies that attacked you along the way, that have oppressed you, that have tried to take advantage of you. Look at what I have done for you." How many of you love that chorus we sing periodically? "Look what the Lord has done. Boom, boom, boom. Look what the Lord has done." Why? Because we need to be reminded of those things. God does the same thing when He comes to us as well. He reminds us of how He saved us, how He's healed us, how He's delivered us, how He's set us free. He reminds us of the prayers that He answered. Why? Because we need to have that as an anchor to look to for the promises of God, to hope for the future. That's what God does for us. He does wonderful things inside of our lives. I read a story about two elderly women in church once. They were discussing some of the problems that you have when you grow older. And one of them said, "The worst thing is when your memory starts to go. I've known you all my life, and I can't think of your name. What is it?" And the second lady thought for a moment. She said, "Well, do you need an answer right now?" I hope we don't get that bad with it. But how do you know we need to be reminded? That's what preaching is. Some people get tired. "Well, Pastor, I've heard that before. Well, guess what? You're going to hear it again. Because there are certain things that even though you may know them, because of the human capacity to forget and because we can't always focus on everything all at once, God will always, by your Spirit, bring what we need to our attention by reminding us. reminding of us of his promises, of his word, what he's done for us. Lest we forget what God has done in us and what he's done for us, he reminds us. Because if we forget what he's done in us and what he's done for us, how many know that will have an impact upon your life in a bad way. So in order for us to see what God really sees in us, first he has to deal with the sin, the problems. And he does this by the second thing. God reproves and convicts us when we do not obey what he says. So not only does he remind us what he's done for us, but in order to address what he sees in us that's bad, because he does see that. I mean, God's not blind. I mean, he does see the issues, the problems, the character flaws. He sees what you've done, and you know, he's God. He can't forget it. Well, when the Bible talks about he forgets our sins, it means he chooses not to call it to his remembrance. He's God. He cannot literally forget anything. He wouldn't be God. But he chooses not to. He doesn't allow that to. That's the grace of God. That is what God does. So he reproves and convicts us, though, when we don't obey what he says. You know, the Lord did this with the Israelites. That prophet spoke to them. He spoke a hard word of truth to them. He rebuked them for what was going on there. How many of you are glad that the Holy Spirit will bring that same conviction to us? He doesn't let us get away with doing it forever, but he brings conviction to us. He points out what you just said. He points out what you just did. He points out even what we think sometimes. He goes, you say, well, I thought it wasn't a sin if you just think it. Well, it depends if you keep on thinking about it. See, that initial thought when it pops in your head, you can't control that. That's not a sin. But honey, if you dwell on it, if you keep replaying that, if you let it go over and over and then you focus on it, then you've given your will over to it. And at that point, you need to repent. Does that make sense? You can't stop a bad thought from just popping in your head. You got demons whispering stuff to you. You got idiot people around you that are saying stuff sometimes, and you can't help but overhear that. But you can control what you allow to stay there. And so when it stays there and you start to intentionally dwelling upon that and thinking upon that, you need to repent and ask God to forgive you. Leonard Havenhill was a famous minister of God, and he once said this: there's one thing we need above everything else. It's something we don't talk about these days. We need a mighty avalanche of conviction of sin. That's a powerful statement. And he's talking about his day, which was back in the 50s and the 40s is when he was at the height of his ministry. If it was like that back then, how much more so it is today? We don't want to definitely talk about sin and conviction anymore. We don't want to make people feel bad. Let me tell you something. Unless people feel bad about their sin, they won't ever change and repent to become what God wants them to be. So preachers have to preach against sin. You have to call black, black, and white, white. You have to deal with the issues and say, let's change. God forgives. But what does he forgive? And so I'm glad that God does forgive. So he confronts those issues. And if I offend you at times for what I preach, I don't apologize. I'm not necessarily sorry for that. I'm sorry that your feelings got hurt sometimes, but I will preach the truth as God inspires me to. And that's not a popular subject. I'd rather have us holy all the time than happy all the time. You know, Paul actually wrote that once to the church at Corinth. In the second letter, he said, I'm sorry that you felt that way. Basically, he's apologizing, but he's not really apologizing because he said, you needed what I told you. He addressed some issues, and they changed. He said, that was the whole point of it. He said, I made you sorry, but just for a while, because look at the fruit now. Look at what God has. That's another part of the look what the Lord has done. Thank God for what he does that. All right, so what does God see in us? Well, there's some more things that God sees in us besides the negative. And I think he focuses on what he can do. And that simply comes out of verses 11 through 16. And that's this truth. God calls us to be what he will enable us to be. So not only does he deal with the negative, but mainly he focuses on what he wants us to be, because God will then call you to be the man or the woman of God, to do whatever it is he wants you to do, because he's going to enable you to do that. Look at your neighbor and say, God enables. Isn't that the good news? Because you might think, I can't do that. I don't have that within me. Well, that's fine, because God's going to enable you if he calls you. He will give you the power, the grace, the skill, the anointing supernaturally, or he'll enhance the giftings that you have physically, naturally, and then add his power into that. But God enables when he calls us. Look at verse 11. It goes on to say in verse 11, as soon as I find the page that flipped over here from the fan blowing. It says, now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth tree, which was at Ophrah, belonging to Joash the Abizurite while his son Gideon threshed wheat in the winepress in order to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor." Let me tell you something. Gideon did not think of himself as a mighty man of valor. He's hiding from the enemy in a winepress threshing wheat. All right? Basically so he can have food to eat for himself or his family or whatever. I mean, he's hiding. And God says, "Hey there, you mighty man of valor." And he probably looks around and says, "Who are you talking to?" And then this is what he says in verse 13. Gideon said to him, "Oh, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all the miracles which our fathers have told us about, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' And now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites." And then the Lord turned to him and said, "Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?" God had a time getting through to him, apparently. But he did get through to him. See, God calls us to be what he enables us to be. Why? Because God sees what we can be in Christ. How many know that what you are in your flesh is not the same as who you can be in Christ? Who you are in the natural and the way you've been all your life is not the same as who you are and can be in Christ. Because in Christ, all things are become what? New. In Christ, the old passes away and all things have become new. So God sees what we can be, and he calls us to that because he knows he can enable us to be the very thing he calls us to. It's kind of like your hidden potential. There's an American Indian story that talked about once how a brave found an eagle's egg, and he put it into the nest of some prairie chickens. And so the eagle hatched, and he lived with the brood of prairie chickens, grew up with them, and all of his life he grew up thinking he was a prairie chicken. Never knew he was actually an eagle, and you know, he just did what the prairie chickens did. And one day he saw these eagles flying around, thought to myself, "Well, that is just awesome." And he didn't even know he could fly. And so times goes by, he keeps on seeing this, and he keeps on seeing this, and so finally he points it out to his fellow prairie chickens, and he says, "What beautiful bird is that? And what is it?" And they said, "Well, that's an eagle. That's the chief of the birds. But don't give it a second thought. You can never be like them." So the little eagle never gave another thought, and he died thinking he was a prairie chicken. How many know the devil will deceive you? And even though God says this is what you are and this is what you can be, if you don't believe the word of God, you'll die a chicken instead of being an eagle that God calls us to be. So he calls us, enables us. A couple things with this. First of all, if God is with us, then we can be whatever he calls us to be. If God is with us, then we can be whatever God calls us to be. And we have to understand that. We have to believe that. Gideon was hiding from the enemy in the wine press, threshing the wheat. And God speaks to him and says, "Hey there, mighty man of valor." You see, from what we know of Gideon, he was just a simple farmer. He was not really a warrior, but God saw what Gideon could be in the power and strength that God was going to give him. And that's what he called him to. That's what he challenged him to. See, that's the same thing that God does for us today. We can be the same, or we can be whatever God calls us to be. The only thing that can stop us is your unwillingness to obey and step out in faith. The only thing that can hinder you, even the devil can't stop you, but you can stop yourself if you don't have the willingness to obey and the faith to take God at his word and just believe like God wants us to be. Philip Brooks once wrote this. It's a poem. He said, "Bad will be the day for every man when he becomes absolutely content with the life he is living, with the thoughts he is thinking, and with the deeds he is doing. Where there is not forever meeting at the doors of his soul some great desire to do something larger, which he knows that he has meant and made to do because he is still the child of God." We can't be content just with the way things are always. We got to say, "God, what do you want me to be? What do you want me to do?" And then believe God for that, because he calls us to be what he enables us to be. Second principle that comes out of this section is this, that supports this. If we want to reach our potential, then we must not doubt God's love and care for us. If you want to be the man or the woman of God that he wants you to be, if you want to do something that God calls you to, then you cannot doubt his love and his care for you. I believe that is at the root of how the devil ultimately tricked Eve into sinning back in the Garden of Eden. When the devil or the serpent spoke to her and said, "Hath God said?" What is he doing there? He's insinuating something to her and inserting doubt into her mind of what God said. But behind that is the other thing he said, "Don't you know that if you eat of the fruit of it, you won't die?" You see, the second part of that was then to get her to doubt the goodness of God and the care of God and God's love for her, because he made her think, God is keeping something good from me. And so therefore, if God is keeping something good from me, he must not be good. He must not really love me like he's telling me, because he's hiding something from me. He's keeping something from me. And so in those two statements, the serpent got Eve to doubt God's integrity, to doubt his word, to basically doubt everything that God was. How many of you got to have faith in the love of God? God loves me. God accepts me and calls me unto himself. He forgives me. If we want to reach our potential, we've got to understand that. Gideon heard God's call to that, but then he challenged it. He questioned it. He said, "Well, God, if you really care about Israel, you know, then why have you let all this happen to us? And where's all the miracles that we've been, you know, told about and blah, 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 blah?" Well, God basically answered him by not really answering him. You know what God said to him? "Hey, get off of your rear end and go do what I called you to do with the strength you've already got." God said, "Go in this your might." In other words, the might that you've got, whatever abilities and talents you have, go with it. I will be with you. And how many know if God is with you, then who can be against you? God didn't answer all of his little silly questions, because we do that with God all the time. Why? And then we go in this, we throw our own little nice pity party. We have balloons and we have little party favors and we have cake to go along with it sometimes, because we like to have our cake and eat it too. In a pity party, you can do that. But you know, God doesn't always answer those questions, does it? He just basically says, "All right, shut up and get on with it. Just do what you can do here, and I will bless it because I'm with you." We've got to understand the significance. If God is with us, what are we worried about? Why are we fretting? Why are we stewing? Why are we this? If God, but now there is that point, though, is God with us? Because now if you're behaving and living and doing something stupid and talking whatever, then maybe God ain't necessarily with you in the sense of he's going to bless. I mean, God chastens that. But if you've repented and you've got your heart right with God, then you can go do whatever God calls you to do, because he enables us along with that. We have to trust in God's love and his grace for us. Years ago, a man named Brother Lawrence, he once said this: "When we are in doubt, God's will never fail to give light when we have no other plan than to please him and to act in love for him." If I'm having doubts about God's will or what he wants me to do, then I just simply need to say, "God, I want to please you, I want to love you." And somehow through that, God will bless and lead and empower me. If I want to reach my full potential, I have to stop doubting his love for me. I have to say, "Yes, God." And that brings me to a third thing. If God leads, then God has already made provision for our needs. If God is leading you, then you didn't understand. He's already put in place what you need in order to succeed. He's already made provision for that. It's just you've got to find it, you've got to discover it, you've got to remain faithful in the process. How many are thankful that God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills? And he can beef one every now and then if you need to eat. I had steak last night. I grilled out on the grill. I made chicken. I made kielbasa sausages. I made hamburgers. And I made me a ribeye steak. And ribs. I had a little of everything going out there. When I do a grill, I'm going to grill. And then I don't cook for a few days, because I'm going to be eating all of that for the next few days unless Joshua eats it all. Sometimes that happens. Aren't you glad God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills? He knows what you need. God told Gideon to go in that might. Why? Because God knew he had already provided. He had things set in place. You see, and God was even willing, if you read the rest of the chapter, even to confirm his will to get him even further. And so Gideon asked for a test, and he brought some food there, and the angel of the Lord touched the food, and it was consumed instantly with fire, and that convinced Gideon, this is God, this is his will. And he went forth then to start making preparations. And God spoke to him and said, "Be at peace, don't be afraid." How many are glad that God can give you peace in the midst of whatever you're going through, and you don't have to be afraid? That brings me to a little meme I found that goes along with this point. It says it a little bit different. It says, where God leads, he meets needs. Where God guides, he provides. Trust in that. Believe God. Thank him for that. Why? Because he does see some good things in us, at least in Christ, that could be in us. That brings me to my third point, and I'll close with this main thing here. God consecrates us to himself by separating us also from worldliness. He separates us from worldliness and consecrates us unto himself. I don't have time to read it, but maybe this afternoon or later on, if you want to read the rest of the chapter, verses 25 through 35, you'll find an interesting account, because after God calls him and after Gideon initially says yes, and he even has that first little test, that night God gave Gideon a test to see if he's going to be faithful, if he's going to be obedient, if he's going to follow through, and he tells him to do something that is really difficult. He tells Gideon to go and destroy the altar of Baal and to cut down the idol that his father had made and set up in the city. You know, and you have to understand, at that point, it's a highly patriarchal society. The father is the leader of the home, and even if you're an adult kid with your own family, you still don't go against dad. And so Gideon is in this dilemma. God has just spoken to him because his father's the one that apparently made the idol and dedicated the thing, and everybody in the town was worshiping this false god of Baal. But God knows that if they don't deal with the sin and get rid of the idolatry, that he can't bless them. So he challenges Gideon. He says, I want you to go destroy that. And Gideon obeys God. He goes out with some men that were faithful to him. He cuts down the altar. He destroys the idol and everything. And God did an awesome thing there. A famous minister named D.L. Moody, he said this once. He said, I thought when I became a Christian, I had nothing to do but just lay my oars on the bottom of my boat and float along. But I soon found that I would have to go against the current. There's that naivety in some of us sometimes. We think, well, I got the Lord now. I gave my heart to Jesus, and God's blessing is just going to be with me, and I can lay the oars in the bottom of the boat, sit back, take a nap, and just coast along. And all of a sudden we realize, no, you got to row against the flows, because the world is going this way, and God is going this way. But how many of you glad that God can empower you to row against the flow? Matter of fact, I think with the Holy Ghost, he even puts an outboard motor on the back of your boat. so you can go against the strongest flow. But that's what God does for us. But we have to separate from the world. Two things. First of all, we need to put God first above everything else. Turn to your neighbor and say, first. God's got to be first. You got to put him above everything else. All the things that are in this world, and even those things that you hold on to and love above everything else, will you put God first above that? And see, people that won't do that will not be what God sees in them. They won't reach that potential. Even though Gideon was afraid, he obeyed God. He proved himself faithful, and God blessed him, and then we'll see later on what God did through him. But even still, Gideon had some doubts, so this is that famous part where he asked God about the fleece. He said, I'll put this fleece on the ground, and if it's wet and the ground around it is dry, then I'll know in the morning that it is true. And he still has doubts at that point, so God, then he reverses and says, okay, God, if the fleece is dry the next morning and the ground around it's wet with dew, then I'll believe this is you, and God does it again for him. You know, at that point, I would have been a little upset, me. I'd have said, you idiot, get with the program. You quit asking me for signs, but God was gracious to him. But that's God's right, because there were times where God said no when people kept asking for signs. He said, I've given you enough signs. How many know that ultimately we just got to take God and believe his word? But there are times where God will confirm his will to us, and he wants us to have that assurance. And so he put God first at that point, and just like Gideon, we need to obey God and step out and begin doing what God wants us to do. C.S. Lewis once said this, if you read history, you'll find that Christians who did most for the present world were precisely those who thought the most of the next. It is since Christians have already ceased to think of the other world that they've become so ineffective in this world. Did you catch what he meant by that? Basically, he's saying we need to, as Christians, be mindful and be thinking of the next world. Paul says it this way in one of his epistles, set your mind on things above, not on things on this earth. We need to be heavenly minded because that's our home. That's where we're ultimately going. And he said, because we forget that and we focus on this world, we become ineffective for God right here and right now. There is a balance to that. You still need to live and exist in this world and do things. But how many know you got to keep your focus on heaven itself, that heavenly home and all that God promises us. Put God first, because if you will put him first, you can be separated from the worldliness, and then you can see what God sees in you because it'll be fulfilled. And that brings me to the final point. We can also be filled with the Holy Spirit. How many are glad that God fills his people with the Holy Ghost? If you read on in that chapter, it says a little bit later on that because basically Gideon was faithful, that God then empowered him. The Spirit of the Lord, it says, came upon him. And he began to blow the trumpet and call those to rally around him to be the army that God was going to use there and to fight the enemy. But I just want to point out, he was basically filled with the Spirit. And I thank God that when we are consecrated to the Lord and we separate from the world, that we can be filled with the Holy Ghost. And that's something that we as Pentecostals can never abandon and get away from, because you need the power of God's Spirit in your life 24/7. Somebody keeps saying, well, can't you get to heaven without the Holy Ghost? Well, yeah, you can get to heaven because you got Jesus in your heart, but it makes the journey a whole lot easier if you got the power of the Holy Ghost flowing through you and moving in you, and you can minister more effectively to people around you because the gifts of the Spirit will flow through you if you're filled with the Spirit. We need the power of God. And that's what God sees in us. And everything I'm sharing with you this morning, what does God see in us? Yes, he does see the bad. He will deal with that. But he doesn't just focus on that only. He deals with that so that he can also see the good and the wonderful things that he can be in you come forth. Because greater is he that's in us than he that's in this world. If God be for us, who can be against us? God sees an awesomeness inside of us because it's himself. It's the power of God. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's what I've got a desire to know. Matter of fact, Paul said that. I don't want to know anything about you guys. He said, but I want to know Christ in you. Too many times you're focusing on the negative things or the issues that so-and-so has, and you got to let go of that and quit talking about that and quit. You got to focus on what God has. Start seeing that and praying for that. J.B. Phillips, I'll close with this quote. Famous minister, he said this, every time we say, I believe in the Holy Spirit, we mean that we believe that there is a living God able and willing to enter human personality and change it. Every time I say Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, that's a statement of faith saying, I believe that there is a living, almighty, all-powerful God who is able to enter into the heart of a person and change them. Do it to me, Lord. More than just empower me to go do miracles, God, change me from the inside out. Don't let me stay and remain the miserable, rotten, cranky, irritated person that I've always been, that's living in sin and bondage or whatever. Lord, change me. Gut me out and replace it. Give me the mind of Christ. Fill me with the Holy Ghost so that I can be the man or the woman of God that he wants me to be. That's who God sees in us. That's who God sees us. So God confronts the issues that hinder us. Thank God for that. He calls us to be what he enables us to be. And he consecrates us unto himself by filling us with the Holy Spirit. See, God sees everything in us, both the good and the bad, but he also sees what we can be in Christ. And that's what he wants us to bring us into. And he'll do that, honey, if you surrender fully to him. I'll close with just quoting this one verse. He that has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of the Lord Jesus. How many are glad that what God has begun in us, he can bring it to a completion? You just got to stay faithful and hold on for the ride. Because let me tell you something, it's like the ride of your life. I know some of you guys got motorcycles and you like to get out there and go blowing down the highway. And you forget sometimes that the person hanging on behind you is literally hanging on behind you. For dear life, sometimes. I can remember as a child, my dad had a bike, and he'd go riding down that highway, and I'm just hanging on for dear life. Like, it was fun, but it was scary as all get out, too. It's a good thing I couldn't see anything in front of me, because all I saw was the back of his shirt. That's how God is sometimes, and maybe we don't need to see. You just need to have faith and trust that he's got the ride. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Would you pray with me?